Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niyame Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Pashchatya Desha Tarine Vancha Kalpata Rubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Atitanam Bhavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhuvindavyananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sri Vasadi Gaura Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare
Hare Krishna. Thank you for coming today evening. And yesterday we were discussing, how many of you were there yesterday? Okay, a few of you are not there. Thank you. So I was speaking on this topic of how Krishna, the Supreme Lord, is our ultimate benefactor, and he may sometimes put us in illusion to actually benefit us. So I talked about the Mohini Murti Dila, the pastime in which the Lord becomes the enchanting female who deludes the demons when they are trying to grab the nectar for themselves. So today I'll talk about the second part of the pastime and what we can learn from it. The Srimad Bhagavatam describes pastimes that are meant to tell us about the highest principles of life. And the highest purpose of life is to attain pure love for Krishna. So the Bhagavatam begins with the idea that dharma projita kaitavatra paramo nirvatsaranam satam. It says that dharma projahita gives up that dharma which is kaitava. The word kaitava means sub-religious principles or false religious principles or cheating religious principles. The idea is that whenever we approach a particular thing, we approach it with certain expectations. Say, if we get some inheritance from someone and then we go to the, it's an old house with many things kept over there. And we go and we think, oh, these are all just some old junk. And then we dispose it off. And in disposing it off, at that time, if some piece of what junk gives us a good amount of money, say something such as $100, $500, okay, I got a very good deal. But actually, later, if we come to know that that junk is actually not junk, but it's a precious antique. And instead of $500, we could have got $50,000 for it. Then what would have earlier seemed to be a very good deal will seem to be like a terrible deal. It's a terrible loss. So generally, before we can invest or trade anything, we need to understand its value. And for many things, their value is not just apparent on immediately looking at things. So similarly, if we consider we all have our life ahead of us and we all consider our life to be precious, we want to do something with our life. And we generally think that if we get a good job, we have a good career, if we have a good family, if we have a respectable position in society, then this is what life is meant for. And if we can achieve this, we think my life is successful. And most people, considering this to be the purpose of life, they think that whatever help I can get for achieving this purpose, I will seek that. And they think God also has one resource. yes, I want to achieve this, but it's not in my power to get it. So I pray to God. And by praying to God, by getting His help, I'll achieve my goals. And if somebody is able to achieve, they get good position in society, they become famous in the world, think, oh, I've been successful. And God has blessed me. That's how they tend to think. Now, at one level, it is true. But human life can offer us something much bigger. Human life is an opportunity for the soul to understand the eternal, to love the eternal, and ultimately to attain the eternal. Everything that we attain in life, even if, however praiseworthy it may be, it is still temporary. So when we don't know about eternal life, we are like that person who, on getting a few hundred dollars for something, think we got a very good deal. But when we understand that in human life, we can get, if we have the advanced consciousness by which we can learn to love the eternal, okay, understand that we ourselves are eternal as souls, we have an eternal relationship with the Supreme Soul Krishna, and when we learn to love Him, we attain eternal life thereby. So once we understand this, then anything that distracts us from this, we consider that as an obstacle. So when the Bhagavatam says Kaitava Dharma, it talks about that dharma which people use for getting artha and kama. When people practice dharma so that they can get wealth and they can fulfill their desires. And he says this dharma is actually Kaitava. Because this Kaitava means it underutilizes the potential of our life. And instead, if somebody can get eternal life, then that is what is much more laudable, is much more glorious. So therefore, the Bhagavatam depicts how different people in different yugas ultimately attain this goal of gaining eternal life. And of gaining, how do we gain eternal life? It is by gaining love for the Supreme Eternal Reality. When we have devotion for Krishna, then Krishna has no reason to keep us in this world. As long as we love the things of this world, as long as we want to enjoy the things of this world, then that very desire keeps us here. But when our love for Krishna becomes greater than the love for this world, at that time we attain Krishna. Now, there are times when the worldly gain and the otherworldly gain, the material gain and the spiritual gain can go together. And there are times when the two may go in opposite directions. In the normal course of our life, we have our family, we have our profession, and we try to spiritualize it as much as possible. We bring God into the center of our lives. We see our family as not our family, but actually Krishna's family interested in our care. We see our job not just as our job, it is by Krishna's arrangement that we have that job. To have, in every job that we do, we have some abilities which we use. So to have abilities is a gift. To realize that we have abilities is a greater gift. Because many people have abilities, they don't even realize that they have the abilities. Just go through life trying things which they are not good at, while neglecting what they are good at. So to realize that we have abilities is a greater gift. But to realize that our abilities are a gift, that is the greatest gift. So our abilities are not ours, they are given to us by Krishna. And when we understand this, then our ability doesn't make us proud. Ability brings humility also. This is Krishna's gift, which I'll use for serving Him, contributing in this world in the mood of service to Him. So there are times when the para and the apara dharma will go together. So for example, whenever we belong to any society, any social group, we want to feel accepted and respected in that group. That's just a natural human longing. And then when we come in the devotee community, we learn etiquette of humility and respectfulness by which we respect each other. And that sense of belonging, that sense of appreciation, that sense of being valued, we get that in the devotee community. But sometimes the this worldly gain and the other worldly gain can go in opposite directions. Or sometimes when the this worldly goals, they obstruct us in going towards the other worldly goals, then Krishna may make some special arrangement. And at that time, if we have grown up with the idea that this worldly goals are the blessings of Krishna, then we will think, where is Krishna? Where is Krishna's blessing to me? Krishna is not providing me anything at all. Rather, Krishna is taking everything away from me. So such a, at that time, how we can see things spiritually? That is what the Bhagavatam reveals through different characters. And one such pastime comes in the 8th canto associated with the Mohini Murti. After the Mohini Murti deludes the asuras. And thereafter, she gives the nectar to the devatas. Then she departs. And then when Lord Shiva, there are administrative devatas and there are the primal devatas. So generally Brahma and Shiva, they don't get involved very much in the usual fights between the devatas and asuras. Sometimes they may be involved, but not usually. So that's why Lord Shiva is not there when Mohini Murti appears. And then when Lord Shiva hears, Mohini Murti, she came and she deluded all the demons. So he desires, my beloved Lord, my dear Lord, my exalted Lord, my worshipful Lord, I've never seen him in a form like this. Nobody has heard about such a form. So he said, I would like to behold him in this form. And then when he hears this, at that time, with this desire in his heart, he approaches Lord Vishnu. And he approaches Lord Vishnu and he offers prayers to him. And he says, with his prayers, he makes a request. He says, I would like to see your wonderful form, which you displayed in the Amrit Manthandila. In the Greco-Roman tradition, there was a philosopher who said that when God wants to curse you, when the gods, they have the idea of gods, multiple gods, some higher beings. When the gods want to curse you, they fulfill your prayers. What that means is that sometimes our own desires may be dangerous. We desire something which you think will make us happy, but after that, they just become terribly unhappy. Almost everybody in the world wants to be famous. If we come to a room and everybody looks, notices who's come here, and appreciates, admires, we feel a sense of titillation from that. So that if we consider from anonymity, at the state where we are not known much, to the top of a mountain, that's fame. So, most people are struggling to climb up this mountain from anonymity to fame. And most people are not able to succeed. And most people are frustrated. You know, I'm not famous enough. I'm not well known enough. I want to be well known. But when you get to the top of the mountain, actually what happens is two things. Nobody stays famous for a very long time. So, from there, there's a very steep fall. And see, this steep fall is extremely painful. For somebody to have been very famous and then to not be recognized by anyone, that's extremely painful. One of my friends in California is doing a PhD in sociology in the post-celebrity lives of baseball players, sports players, specifically baseball players. So when they are in sports careers, they're very glamorous at one level, but they're very short-lived. By the age of 40, most players have to retire. So, now most of these players, they get into severe depression. Unless they can create a sense of another identity for themselves, they just can't accept the fact that they were so famous at one time and nobody now cares for them. So, one problem is that we may climb up, but after that there's a big slide down. Even if you go up the mountain of fame, from here we only see how high and majestic the mountain is. But when we come down, When I will get there, it's like there's a powerful wind which won't allow us to stay there. It just push us. And from there, it's a steep drop down. And on top of that, the people who are not very famous, they always strive to become famous. But most celebrities, they actually strive and struggle for some privacy. So I said, most celebrities, they say that one famous musician, he said that, I spent all of my youth trying to become famous. And now, all of my middle age, I have to spend trying to be anonymous. They want to go out anywhere, they can't go out because they're mobbed by people. So anyway, the point which I'm making over here is that fame is a two-edged sword. We see only its pleasant side, but not its unpleasant side. So here, when Lord Shiva, he desires to see. So many of us may desire to be famous, but actually sometimes that fame may become the cause of distress for us. Later when the fame is lost, or even before, when the fame is no longer, fame takes away our privacy from us. So when Lord Shiva desires this, so then Lord Vishnu smiles ruefully. And then he nods his head. And generally, when one form of the Lord is there, and the Lord is about to reveal another form, then the previous form disappears. It's just like when Arjuna asks Krishna, please show me the Virat Rupa. So when Krishna reveals the Virat Rupa, at that time now, in our pictures that we draw, we sometimes have to, because we are in two-dimensional space, when we draw the pictures, we cannot depict the full reality. So we may show that Arjuna is here, Krishna is here, and Krishna is pointing like this. And Krishna is showing the universal form to Arjuna. Arjuna is looking at the universal form. But it's not like that. When actually Arjuna saw the universal form, he no longer saw Krishna. And that's why when Arjuna asked the question, Akhya hi me ko bhavan ugra rupo, who are you? Because he saw the Vishwarupa, and the Vishwarupa was fine. He knew the Vishwarupa. The whole universe be pervaded. But Krishna also showed the Kala Rupa. Kala Rupa means the form of, as time, who is the destroyer of the whole world. So, suppose we know a person, very friendly and nice and sweet and kind. And then one day when you are talking with them, suddenly that person starts yelling and shouting and screaming. And they start behaving completely uncharacteristic of the way we know them. Who are you? What have you done to my friend? Where have you taken my friend away? Who is the strange person who has come in your body? So Arjuna asks like this. So the point is that when Lord Shiva desires to see the Mohini Murti form and Vishnu nods, so then Vishnu disappears. And then Lord Shiva is expectantly waiting. Where will he see? And then as he is looking around, when Lord Shiva went, it is actually a pious desire. It says, I want to have darshan of the Lord. So when he had approached and prayed to Lord Vishnu, at that time, Lord Shiva's consort, Parvati, was also with him. And then as he was looking around, suddenly he sees a beautiful form of a very young, attractive girl. And she is playing with a ball and she's just moving around. And she's so captivating to look at, that Lord Shiva completely loses his perspective of everything. And in this world, when illusion appears, illusion can captivate us at any moment. Krishna says, Sarvadharman Pratyajya Mamekam Sharanam. He says, give up all varieties of illusion and surrender unto me. But when illusion, Maya tempts us, then our condition becomes, Sarvadharman Pratyajya Maya Mekam Sharanam. You may forget everything and just get captivated by illusion. So at that time, as Lord Shiva is observing, he sees this beautiful damsel and he gets completely captivated by her. Our senses are like radars. And a radar is always scanning the horizon. When it's scanning the horizon, it is looking for any suspicious looking object, any enemy missile, any enemy aircraft. And as soon as the radar sees anything suspicious, it zeroes in on it. And then it highlights, it shows what it is. So like that, our senses are like pleasure-seeking radars. And as soon as any enjoyable object comes in, then immediately the senses just zoom in on it. And then we forget everything else. We forget everything else, and the same thing happened to Lord Shiva. He was with his wife, but he completely forgot about that. And he just started gazing at this beautiful woman. And then as he was gazing at her, then she started she was just moving around very gracefully, very enticingly. And as she was moving around, sporting, she was playing with the ball and started moving away. And then Lord Shiva immediately started going after her. And started going after her, and she kept running. And then, as she kept moving, he also kept moving after her. Wherever she went, he kept moving. And generally speaking, the nature of the world is that there are many tempting objects that come up all around us. But for all of us, when the temptations come up, we are civilized enough to control our desires. The desires may come up, but we don't act on all our desires. Now, we can only see each other's actions, or at most expressions. We cannot see each other's minds.
Good.
Yeah, we cannot see each other's minds, and that is a great blessing. If we started seeing each other's minds, not a single relationship could be sustained. It is not just it's not just necessarily terrible desires come up within us, but also terrible emotions come up within us. Sometimes we get angry with someone, and then we may start thinking such terrible thoughts about that person. If that person came out, you'll think like this about me. Not a single relationship would survive. So nature has given us this buffer by which desires may come up within us, emotions may come up within us, but we learn to rein in those emotions. We learn to restrain those emotions. One of the greatest civilizing forces in the world is the religious awareness that there is a God to whom we are accountable for our actions. When this awareness is removed from the world, then anything becomes right. If you can just get away with what we feel we are doing, we can do, then we'll get away. We think that I'll do it. So basically, we all need impetuses for curbing our impulses. If we don't have that impetus for curbing our impulse, then our impulses will carry us away. So just our culture, our relationships, what will people think of me? And ultimately, God is in control, I'm accountable for my actions. All these are what curb our impulses, what enable us to curb our impulses. At the same time, sometimes some desires, when they pop up, they can grow so forcefully that we just don't care for any impulses. Let's say we don't care for any restraints. We don't care for any other considerations. And when somebody becomes like this, that they just don't care for anything else at all, normally we would consider such a person as irresponsible, as uncultured, as shameless. The Bhagavatam in the 6th canto itself describes the story of Ajamil, who gets attracted by a society girl, and then he just leaves his family for her. And the Bhagavatam is quite strong in condemning his irresponsible actions. So when this happens, normally we would consider such a thing to be very uncultured and shameless. But when something like this happens to a person who is very cultured and respectable, that can be very scary, that can be very unnerving. How can such a force catch someone like that? And as this, Mohini Murti, she just starts moving. Now Lord Shiva is trying to catch her. As he's observing her and he's seeing her beauty, he's getting more and more captivated by her. So, when he gets so captivated by her that he just can't think about anything else, he starts running wildly after her. And as he's running wildly after her, he goes into the forest, And she runs not just into the forest, she runs into that part of the forest where there are great sages who are meditating. And the great sages who are meditating, at that time, she runs through them and Lord Shiva runs through them also. And they see it, they're shocked. What is Lord Shiva doing over here? What is Lord Shiva doing like this? We all may have our desires, but we have a sense of what you could say contextual appropriateness. What that means is that Jayadvaita Maharaj was there at the New York Rath Yatra, and there are a lot of people come and people often ask provocative questions. So one person asked this question. He says, why are you people so much against sex? He said, no, we are not against sex. We are against only contextually inappropriate sex. What do you mean by that? He said, imagine the President of India is there. President of America is there. And the President of America is giving the State of the Union address. And the President of America may like pizza. So now, giving the State of the Union address is an important activity. Eating pizza is also fine. There's nothing wrong. But if while giving the State of the Union address, the President is eating pizza, that is inappropriate. So there is a time, place, circumstance for according to which certain activities are appropriate and certain activities are inappropriate. So he says, today's world, the problem is that sexuality is so much glamorized that people don't think about the contextual appropriateness of things. That's why the desires grow wild and society tends to then get degraded. So now, even say in Mayapur is the international headquarters of the Krishna Consciousness Movement. It is in Bengal in India. So Mayapur, we have beautiful, it's a very beautiful, huge premises. And there are gardens over there are temples, there are places for people to do kirtans, go on parikrama, ethics. Now there are gardens over there and many young people come there, young couples come there. And the gardens were initially established, they were one of the best gardens in that part of Bengal. So many young couples would come and do romantic things over there. Now, then the devotees had to put a notice, this is a temple, this is a sacred place. You want to do romance, do it somewhere else, not in the temple. Isn't it? So there are some things which are contextually inappropriate. So here, for Lord Shiva, when Mohini Murti captivated him, and Mohini Murti just took him straight through the places where his own followers were there. The sages were the followers of Lord Shiva. And this would have been normally so embarrassing for someone. But Lord Shiva was so captivated, they didn't even notice it. So he didn't even notice it and just kept chasing. And finally, he got to Mohini Murti. And as soon as he touched her, the excitement, the energy reached a peak and then that went down. So when it went down, then he immediately came back to his senses. And he looked around and he saw everybody was looking at him. He says, what did I do? And then as he was looking, see Mohini Murti, she just, after she does her action, she just disappears. So he looked around, there's no Mohini Murti there. So then, Lord Shiva could have become embarrassed, he could have become mortified. It was an embarrassing situation, no doubt. But at that time, his response is exemplary. What was his response? He said that, if there are prayers in the Bhagavatam, he says that, actually, he is known as Dhira. He is known as sober person. One who is never bewildered. He said that, the fact that I was bewildered proves how glorious my Lord is. Rather than thinking, oh, what a terrible thing I have done, he says, how glorious is my Lord? That only He could have bewildered me. No one else could have bewildered me like this. So I wanted to see Mohini Murti. Now, what is special about Mohini Murti is that she can do Mohan, she can delude. So, Lord, when His desire was there, I want to behold the Mohini Murti. The speciality of that form was the capacity to delude. And if you see the Bhagavatam, in the first verse itself says, Muhiyanti yat surayaha. That by that absolute truth, even the suras are deluded. So the Lord is beyond the, Lord is greater than the asuras, and the Lord is greater than even the suras. Asuras are the devatas, asuras are the demons. So here, the whole purpose of the Bhagavatam is to demonstrate the glory of the Lord. And when Lord Shiva becomes deluded like this, he rather than focusing on his own humiliation, he focuses on the Lord's glorification. Oh, how glorious is my Lord? Only he could delude me. And this proves that he is omnipotent. A person who would never be deluded, that person got deluded. This proves his omnipotence. So this means that actually, if we are trying to practice Krishna consciousness, we are trying to become spiritually conscious. If we can't succeed in Krishna consciousness, then we can fail in Krishna consciousness. Not fail out of Krishna consciousness. What is the difference between fail in and fail out of Krishna consciousness? That means that rather than thinking that Krishna consciousness needs a certain set of standards, this is what I have to follow. If I don't follow it, I'm not Krishna conscious. But if I understand that actually it is not just following certain standards, but it is not just following certain standards, but actually working on developing a consciousness of Krishna, that is important. To the extent we develop the consciousness of Krishna, to that extent we grow in our spiritual life. To that extent we move forwards towards Krishna. So Krishna consciousness is not just about activity, it is about the mentality, about the consciousness. So Prabhupada was so inclusive in his vision of Krishna consciousness. He said that if suppose somebody is an alcoholic, and they can't give up alcohol, then rather than thinking that, oh, I can't give up alcohol, I can't give up alcohol, I can't give up alcohol, Prabhupada said that if when they're taking wine, if they think at that time that the taste of wine is actually the taste of Krishna. Krishna said, I am the taste of water. And wine is a form of water, it's liquid. So if they think that the taste of wine is actually manifesting the attractiveness of Krishna, then, by remembering Krishna in this way, one day they will become great devotees. He's not saying by drinking wine one will become great devotees. No. That it is by remembering Krishna, that this attractiveness which is captivating me so much, is actually the attractiveness of Krishna. And this attractiveness can help me to become a devotee of Krishna. This attractiveness, if I remember that and appreciate that, we can grow towards Krishna. I'll explain this point a little bit more. If we consider different people's attitudes towards God, we could say there are atheists who say there is no God. Then there are polytheists who say there are many gods. Then there are monotheists who say there is one God. So atheists is no God. Polytheists is
many
gods. Monotheists is one God. So this is, you could say, is evolution. Evolution in our conception of devotion. Now we could say Krishna consciousness is monotheism. But actually it is more than that. Beyond this, there is no God, there are many gods, there is one God. Two, there is only God. There is only God means what? That God is the one reality who includes all realities. The Bhagavatam says in the Chatushloki, Aham evasam evagre nanyat sadasat. He says, I existed in the beginning, I exist now, and I will exist in the future. So that, now does that mean that I don't exist, you don't exist, God is only God? No. Yes. What it means is that we do exist. But we don't exist separate from God. We are all parts of God. So God is not just some person who exists far away in the spiritual world somewhere. Yes, he is that. But God has multiple manifestations. So God exists as a person in the spiritual world, but God exists as an all-pervading presence also. not just an all-pervading presence, God exists as an all-encompassing presence. So at one level, everything that exists is God. Sarvam Kalmam Idam Brahma. Everything is divine. At the same time, everything is divine. This has to be carefully understood. Some people say everything is divine. Yes, that is true. But if let's consider this point in a couple of ways. When Hiranyakashipu asks Prahlad Maharaj, this child, small Prahlad, he says, you say you are worshipping Vishnu, where is this Vishnu? Vishnu is everywhere. So then Hiranyakashipu asks, is this Vishnu in this pillar? He says, of course, if he is everywhere in this pillar also. And then Hiranyakashipu goes and smashes that pillar. And from that pillar emerges, Stambe Sabhayam Namrugam Namanusham. That form, she is neither human nor animal. Lord Narasimhadeva was half man, half lion, and full God. He had the full power of God with him. So when he appeared, at that time he made short work of Hiranyakashipu. And then when Prahlad came, now Prahlad had said that everywhere is Vishnu. But when he wanted to offer his obeisances, he wanted to offer a garland, he did not go and garland the pillar. He went and garlanded Narasimha. So God is everywhere, that is true. In that you can say, in a sense, everything is God. But there are certain manifestations of God that are worshipable, that connect our consciousness with Him. So we focus on those manifestations. If we consider the three gunas, that there are many various manifestations of various natures in this world. So some people ask this question, that if everything is made by God, then why are we told to restrain ourselves? Even the beautiful attractive objects in this world are also made by God. Even wine is made by God. So why should we not drink wine? I said, yes, even wine is made by God, but then even poison is made by God. Is it? So, yes, everything comes from God, but everything doesn't take us to God. Everything comes from God, but everything doesn't take us towards God. So, even the attractiveness of wine, the taste of wine is also coming from God. But that taste of wine, if we take the wine, we get intoxicated and we will not go towards God. So, if we consider, this is transcendent, this is divya, and there is sattva, rajas and tamas. So, there are different things that are attractive at different levels. So there are things in tamas also which are attractive. Tamas is the mode of ignorance. Dark, ugly things. You know, people like to watch horror movies with all kinds of shapeshifters and all kind of monstrous beings are there. And now fear is not a very pleasant emotion. But some people, they just crave for that kind of stimulation. So now, is it stimulating? But what is the value of that stimulation? So some people, they actually beat themselves up. They are masochists. Just beat themselves up. And they get some perverse pleasure through that. So there can be various kinds of things which will be attractive to different people. So, and even the attractiveness of anything and everything comes from Krishna. But we have to see whether that attractiveness takes us towards Krishna. So alcohol, its taste also comes from Krishna. But taking alcohol will not take us towards Krishna. When we suppose after this program we have prasad, don't suppose, prasad is there. So, and when we take prasad, the taste of prasad is also nice. But that taste takes us towards Krishna. When we taste Krishna's mercy in the form of his prasad, honoring that prasad, relishing that prasad, it takes us towards Krishna. So, during our journey in life, we focus on those manifestations, those attractive things which will attract us towards Krishna. See, we all like to see beautiful things. So when we come to the temple and see the beautiful deities of the Lord, then our eyes hunger for beauty. When we satisfied in that way, then the eyes, which would normally take us away towards illusion, they can take us towards illumination. They can take us towards liberation. So the Lord is here in transcendence. and we have goodness, passion, ignorance. So whatever it is that we are in, whichever mode we are in, from there we can rise upwards by focusing on those attractive manifestations which connect us with Krishna. Now, what happens if somehow we are attracted to something which is not connected with Krishna? So there are things, there are attractive things which make us conscious of Krishna. Say, if we come to a program and there are devotees who sings very sweet kirtan, and we like to hear, we like to like music and singing, then we are attracted by that. Now that attraction connects us towards Krishna. But suppose if we are attracted to some mundane or romantic music, that may not attract us towards Krishna. That will not attract us towards Krishna. So there are certain attractive manifestations which take us towards Krishna. Certain attractive manifestations which take us away from Krishna. Now even if somebody is singing vulgar songs, but if they have singing talent, their singing ability is also coming from Krishna. Their singing ability is not their own ability. It is God's gift. Unfortunately, they are using it such a way that it will take them away from God. It will take others also away from God. So, but their ability is also a gift of God. So we can become conscious of Krishna even in the things that make us unconscious of Krishna. The things that make us unconscious of Krishna means that if, say, in the past we had liked music, say, and then we like, say, Bollywood music or whatever, and then now when we hear some songs, immediately the mind gets captivated. Or some people like cricket. As soon as they hear some cricket scores, just get so captivated by it. Just forget everything else. So then we have to understand that this thing, when it captivates us, it captivates us. We may forget everything about it. But when that spell gets over, rather than simply beating ourselves up, why did I get so attracted by this? Yes, we do need to correct ourselves, but more important is, you become conscious of Krishna. What is attractive in this? What is so attractive? If you consider a sports player, their ability, it's not just their ability. The best sports player, one day they are in great form, and the next day they are out of form. One day they hit boundaries and sixes, and next day they just get clean ball on a simple straight ball. So no player would want to be out of form. So their ability is not their own ability. So if some player has phenomenal ability, then we should see that their ability is also coming from Krishna. Their ability is also coming from Krishna. Now of course we have to see whether that ability, if we get, we appreciate that in such a way that it takes us towards Krishna. The story of, the highest level of understanding, there is only God. This only God means what? That all of existence is simply God's energy. But some part of that existence will take us towards the divine, and some part of it will take us away from the divine. The story of Shankaracharya, once he was going with his followers, and he came by a wine shop. And he just picked up a wine, some wine. The wine pot he picked up and he looked at it, picked it up and said, Sarvam Khalma Midam Brahma. Everything is Brahma. And he drank it. And his followers looked at it and then said, okay, our Guruji has done it, let us do it. So they also picked it up and they got Sarvam Khalma Midam Brahma. And then after that, Shankaracharya went to a ironsmith. And there in a pot, there was molten iron. And he picked it up. Sarvam Khalvam Idam Brahm. And he drank it. And his followers, they couldn't drink it. So he is Shankaracharya, Shankar. He is an extraordinary person. Teji Yasang Doshaya. That when great people do something extraordinary, we cannot imitate them. So if you see in this same pastime, and the same Leela, right at the beginning of the Amrut Manthan, the journey of the ocean, Lord Shiva's glory is talked about. That he's so compassionate that he's ready to take the poison, to drink the poison which would have killed everyone. So his glory is established right in the beginning. We should not think that he's an ordinary person who is madly captivated by lust. He's such a great person that he's ready to give up his life, ready to drink poison. Of course, the Lord protected him and he did not, the poison did not actually harm him anyway. In fact, Vishwanath Thakur describes that Lord Shiva, for him, even his body is so divine, so potent, that even if the poison had gone into his body, it would not have affected him. But when the poison came into his body, it went up to his neck and it stopped over there. That's why he's known as Neelakanta. His throat became bluish because of the poison. So he says that poison would anyway not have affected him. If the poison has to kill, even if it gets to the level of the neck, also from there also it can kill. So why did he stop it at the level of the neck? So he says, Lord Shiva, in his heart, Lord Vishnu always resides. And he did not want that poison to disturb Lord Vishnu. Now, of course, the poison is not going to disturb Lord Vishnu. But the mood of a devotee is that I want to offer the best to my Lord. So his mood was that I don't want this poison to reach anywhere near my heart. Because from there it could go to the alimentary canal. So he just held it in his neck itself. So his greatness, both in terms of the potency to absorb poison and in terms of his compassion for others because of which he absorbed the poison, that is described very clearly before this very master. And then when he gets deluded like this, the purpose of this is to show how one can fail in Krishna consciousness, not fail out of Krishna consciousness. That means, for him, the normal way to be conscious of Krishna would be that he would chant the names Rama Rama Rameti Rame Rame Manorame Sahasranama Tatulyam Rama Nama Varanane. He tells, when Parvati asks him, there are so many people who chant your names, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya. Whose names are you chanting? He replies that Rama Rama Rameti Rame Rame Manorame. Oh Rama, Rama refers here to Parvati Devi. I am chanting this name and Rame Rame Manorame. It gives me great joy. And he says, Sahasranama Tatulyam Rama Nama Varanane. That the Vishnu Sahasranam, which is a celebrated glorification of the Lord. He says that one name of Ram is equivalent to this Vishnu Sahasranam. So he says, so he is chanting the names of Ram. He is great devotee. So normally he would be conscious of Krishna by chanting the names of the Lord, by meditating on the Lord, by giving instruction to others, by doing his dharmic duties. But at this particular point, he got captivated by Mohini Murti. So he was pulled down from dharma in one sense. But he was not pulled down from dharma. Because dharma is not just conformity to certain rules. Dharma is the cultivation of certain consciousness. There's a difference between the two. Dharma is not just conformity to rules. It is the cultivation of a certain consciousness. And what was that consciousness that he cultivated? That consciousness was that he was always remembering the Lord. As soon as this whole thing got over, he says, oh, my Lord is so wonderful that only he could have deluded me. So when the source, the Lord who is the source of illumination, becomes the source of illusion, what is he teaching us? He's teaching us how to be conscious of him even in the things in which we become unconscious of him. He's teaching us how, even if we fail, we can fail in Krishna consciousness, not fail out of Krishna consciousness. Normally, in any cultural society, even if somebody is in a senior, respected position, even if they have some faults, those faults are not highlighted. That I was at a conference in Silicon Valley, and there we were talking about after the talk I was talking with the many Americans were also there. So we were talking after that about how the cultures work. Now, there's spiritual bhakti which is transcendental, and there's a cultural aspect to it. So while talking about the cultural aspect, they were talking. One of the American employees was telling me that, when I started working on software with Indian teams, No, I just couldn't understand how the Indian culture works. So he said that what I have learned after years of working in Indian culture is that if there's a team in India and the team's boss is there, and if there's some junior person who's very expert in that field. Now, if the boss makes a wrong suggestion also, the subordinate will not speak anything. It's because how can I contradict my boss? This is, the Eastern culture are generally very face-saving cultures. Make sure that your seniors, they are never publicly disrespected. So he says that, now what I've learned is, I tell my colleague, the boss over there, that I know that he's expert in this field, let him speak. So you tell him in advance like that, and then the boss tells him, in this meeting you should speak. Then he will speak. So he says, in America, if something is wrong, the subordinate is there, this will not work. But he says that it doesn't work like that in the Western culture. See, so Western culture is highly individualistic. It is each one on their own. The Eastern culture within India or China, it is much more family-centered or community-centered. And for that, a certain sense of hierarchy is required. So anyway, the point here is, these cultures, the traditional cultures, are generally face-saving cultures. So we see that Ram never blames Kaikeyi or Dashrath. When he's exiled, he doesn't blame them at all. And Lakshman criticizes Dashrath, Ram stops and says, don't criticize. It is not for us to question their words. So generally, even if the elders commit some mistakes, they're not publicly, they're played down so that they can shave their face. So why is it that Lord Shiva's disgrace is publicly broadcasted? It's for everyone to see. And it's not only publicly broadcasted, it is also recorded in the Bhagavatam for everyone to see. The point here is that Lord Shiva is such a great soul that he can even accept humiliation in his service to the Lord. Normally, when we want to do some service, we also want to get some result in this world for the service. We want some appreciation, we want some honor. If we go and talk about Krishna to someone, and that person starts criticizing us, throwing brickbats at us, then next time we're going to talk, we'll talk about, think 10 times, should I go and talk with this person or not? So, normally, Krishna will not put any ordinary devotee to the test. Because ordinary devotees cannot survive such a test. So as I said earlier, that there is the dharma in this world where we practice dharma to get gains in this world. And then there is dharma which is practiced to gain gains beyond this world. That is the paradharma. So sometimes, because of our practice of bhakti, if in this world, not only do we not gain anything, we lose everything. It is extremely difficult to bear. So if somebody is able to bear that, that person is a very great devotee indeed. A very, very great devotee indeed. So for such peace, so Lord Shiva's, if we appreciate, he is so great that the Lord knows that he will be able to tolerate even humiliation for teaching a lesson to the world. So it's not that he is at fault, rather the Lord uses him in this way. And for all of us, what is it that we can learn? I'll talk about three levels and I'll conclude with that. First, as I said, at an individual level, if we do something wrong, if we get captivated by something which is non-devotional, anti-devotional, and we do something wrong, we do need to rectify ourselves. But rather than beating ourselves down, we can try to appreciate, okay, what is it that attracted me in this? And whatever it is that attracted me in this, how can I find something similarly attractive in Krishna? And if we find that thing in Krishna, then we will be able to give that up. As somebody likes alcohol very much. Now, it's not that people like alcohol simply because it tastes good. Some people might be social drinkers. Just want to get a sense of belonging in a particular social group. So if they come and associate with people who don't drink, then they will give up their drinking. So their need was not drinking, their need was a sense of belonging. Some people may drink because they just want to escape from life, just want some relief. So then you could, if they feel captivated by drinking, they think, what am I really looking for? I need relief. Okay, I need relief. How can I get that in the mortal life?
Then they can hear some kirtans, and hear some soothing spiritual music.
Or they can find out some other healthier way to gain relief. And once they get that, then they will not be so captivated by that. So rather than simply beating ourselves, why don't I have willpower? Why do I fall for such things? We can try to see that also an opportunity to be Krishna conscious. What is it that is attracting me over here? And how can that same thing I find in a more healthier way in the process of life? When we have this attitude, then even through a failure, we may grow in spiritual life. The point is that we can always grow towards Krishna by learning how to become conscious of Him in all situations. So every unhealthy craving is a distortion of a healthy need. A sense of belonging is a healthy need. But drinking, the craving to drink, is an unhealthy expression, distortion of that craving, of that need. So we find out the healthy need and we address that. That's at the individual level. At a social level, if we see somebody around us is captivated by something and they're going on a wrong track. At that time, if we normally know them as, if we have known them for a long time and if they are practicing bhakti and if they are spiritually advanced souls, then we have to be cautious. We can't label or condemn them. At the same time, we can't be naive and gullible. If somebody says, I'm chanting Hare Krishna, and they're sleeping and they're snoring, and you're sleeping. No, I was chanting in my mind. Actually, I was chanting with such absorption that I went into Samadhi.
Well, if somebody starts saying that is naive. That is, we can't believe that. So if somebody is justifying what they have done, it's a different thing. But if somebody is normally living a good life and occasionally there's a lapse, then we have to see that there's something else going on over here. That we don't have to judge or label or condemn that person because of one mistake. So everybody slips at times in life. So rather than beating people down for having slipped, we can appreciate for all the journey that they have walked, and we can enable them to help them to rise in whatever way we can. In our life, you know, we have to see that to practice spiritual life, we don't have to treat ourselves or others like a goalkeeper. Now, what is a goalkeeper meant to do? Goalkeepers, you know, they may make 100 saves. But the one ball that passes by them, that is what is remembered. Oh, you let that goal happen, because of that you lost the match. So like that, somebody may have actually resisted temptation 100 times. But then once they succumb to it, and we label them, you are like this only. Somebody may have anger issues and they are trying to control that anger. And you know, dozen times, 20 times, 30 times, they control their anger. But then, once they flare up, see, you will never change. If we label them like that, then they will become very discouraged. And they will actually end up never changing. So spiritual life is not like trying to be a goalkeeper who saves goals. Practicing spiritual life is more like a journey towards Krishna. On that journey towards Krishna, temptation may make us slip. But we can rise and we can keep moving forwards. So even if somebody falls down, there's a difference between falling down and falling away. Falling down means they're on the path to Krishna, but they fall down. They can get up and they can rise and move on. But fall away means that they just give up the path of bhakti. Unfortunately, what happens in societies which have very high moral standards to follow, if somebody falls down, they don't want to fall away. But sometimes when people fall down, everybody broadcasts their fall down so much that it's not just that they fall away, they feel that they're kicked away. They're kicked away.
Once one of Srila Prabhupada's disciples had some problem in his life, and he wrote a letter, a confidential letter to Prabhupada, admitting that he had this problem. And then Prabhupada's letters would be read by his servants. So one of his servants read that letter, and then he told everyone, you know, this person, you thought he's such a great devotee, had this problem. And then everybody came to know about him. And Prabhupada was so upset by that. Prabhupada said, why did you have to tell this to everyone? No, he had written it to me, and I would have dealt with it.
So sometimes you may feel that, okay, this person, we have to tell everyone in public interest. Now, if it is really in public interest, or it is in our ego's interest. Ego's interest could be that we want to tell. We want attention. And if we have some delicious piece of gossip, then that gives us so much attention. I didn't know that.
So generally, we should see that if somebody has fallen, somebody has had some lapse, then we should see that they are like soldiers who are wounded. A soldier who is wounded is sent to a hospital, not to a prison. There's a difference between a wounded soldier and a soldier who deserts the army. Deserters are disgraced, but they are different. Wounded soldiers are not to be disgraced. So similarly, if we come to know also that, say, something has happened with someone, and then somebody is spreading gossip about that, the least that we can do is, don't spread gossip about this. So I'm not interested in this. Sometimes we may say that, no, but you need to know about this. You can't be naive. Okay, then how do we know whether something is prajalpa? You have to see, does this concern me and my service? If it doesn't concern me and my service, then what do I gain by talking about it? If it is, sometimes you say, I just want to be more aware of things. Well, better to be aware of Krishna. Better to be aware of Krishna's pastimes. Now, we may want to talk about things so that if we are to do a particular service, then if somebody has some issues, somebody is not able to do something properly, we need to be aware of it. So how do we know when, if we are speaking the fault of someone, it's being done in the mood of service, or it is done with a sense of ego, to put the other person down, to prove that how special we are. The simple test is that when we speak about the faults of others, do we get pleasure in speaking about it? If we get pleasure in speaking about somebody else's fault, then that means our motives are not noble. Sometimes, with unhappiness, I get no joy in speaking about this. But since you are doing this service, in this situation, I think you should be aware of this. So we can speak that in a mode of service. And in general, if we speak negative about someone, just to be on the safer side, also speak something positive. Okay, this person has this fault, but in the past they have done this. See, the way we speak can make a huge difference in the implication of what we are saying. Say, if we want to, we can report the same facts in such a way that can encourage, that can portray the person positively, or that can portray the person negatively. We can say that he had problems in the past, but he's stable now. Or we can say, he's stable now, but he had problems in the past. You can see the difference? The same facts,
yeah.
But generally in writing it is said, whatever comes at the end of the sentence, that is what registers the most, that is what is remembered. So if we want to appreciate the person and encourage the person, we will use which sentence, first or second? First one or second one?
First
one, yes. He had problems in the past, but he's stable now. But if you want to put down the person, we will say, a second. He's stable now, but don't get carried away by that. He had problems in the past. So, we may have to present the facts, but we should present the facts also in a way that doesn't put down the other person. So, if we have that attitude, that sometimes as a service we may want to inform others about certain things, but we don't do it in a way that puts people down. We do it in a way that simply educates people with what is necessary so that they can do their service. So generally, it is not that, say, if we say that we all have to be humble, and sometimes, suppose somebody has to face disgrace or humiliation, then they can see it as a test from Krishna. And I have to give up this honor and still have to practice bhakti. But that doesn't mean we have to go about and dishonor others. It's not that, suppose I insult someone and then I say, I'm helping you to become humble. That is ridiculous. What about me being humble? Who is going to make me humble? That person will insult me and say that I'm making you humble. It's not like that. Life itself will do that by its own course. So our purpose in speaking with others should be to encourage others. To encourage others in their service in whatever way they are at. So we should speak to give others peace of mind, not a piece of our mind. Our mind is filled with many dirty pieces, unfortunately. Give a piece of our mind, we will explode at others, we will offend others, we will discourage others. We speak to give others peace of mind. So even if the negative reality is to be spoken, it can be spoken in a positive way. And that can uplift others. So the whole pastime, the Mohini Murti, where Lord Vishnu deludes Lord Shiva, the purpose of that pastime is to demonstrate the greatness of Lord Vishnu and the greatness of Lord Shiva. The greatness of Lord Vishnu, that he can delude even those who are never deluded, like Lord Shiva. And the greatness of Lord Shiva, that even when he is deluded, rather than being conscious of his own humiliation, he becomes conscious of Krishna and Krishna's glory. And thus, for all of us, we learn that this world we lose something, at that time still Krishna is with us, and we will lose something in this world to gain something bigger beyond this world. So I'll summarize. I spoke on the theme of how when we practice bhakti, the Bhagavatam demonstrates paradharma. Normally people practice dharma to gain things in this world. We think of the gains in this world, fame, position, power, wealth, as very valuable gains. But life can offer us something eternal, eternal love for Krishna, eternal life. So if we get some inheritance with something which looks like junk, we may get a few $100 for that, but we can actually get several $1,000s for that if we realize its value. So human life, if we think it is meant for worldly gains, then that's like seeking a few $100. So we can get the worldly gains also, but we don't want to let the worldly gains keep us away from the otherworldly, the spiritual gains. The Bhagavatam sometimes demonstrates pastimes where there are great souls who give up the worldly gain to get the otherworldly gain. And that is what is demonstrated through this Mohini Murti pastime. So when Lord Shiva desires to see Mohini Murti, his desire is a pious desire. Because he wants to have darshan of another form of the Lord. But sometimes our desires can turn out to be dangerous for us. So we have to carefully select what desires we desire to fulfill. And then, when he sees Mohini Murti, he just gets captivated and starts running after her, going after her even in the presence of his wife and even the presence of sages who respect him. So generally, many desires or emotions come up within us, but nature has given us the buffer that people can't see our minds. So civilized society means that the fear of disgrace, the fear of shame keeps us from doing things which are considered reproachable or shameful. And of course there's the fear of God also ultimately, which can also keep us on the right track. So in general we want fame in this world, but if most people struggle to get fame and fail, even those who succeed, then they fall from fame to anonymity, and that's very painful. And even when the fame is there, they struggle to have their privacy. So fame is not all that it is touted to be. And Lord Shiva, if this pastime loses his fame, he is considered to be an exalted soul who instructs others in dharma. He is among the greatest of devatas. But then when he is publicly disgraced by chasing after Mohini Murti, then as soon as he regains his senses, at that time, rather than beating himself up, he glorifies the Lord. So if you can't succeed in Krishna consciousness, you can fail in Krishna consciousness, not fail out of Krishna consciousness. So we normally, there are certain things which make us conscious of Krishna and certain things which make us unconscious of Krishna. But we can become conscious of Krishna even in the things that make us unconscious of Him. Everything attractive comes from God. And if we see the attractiveness of those things as coming from God, then we can become God conscious through those things also. But we don't focus on those things because everything attractive comes from God. Everything attractive doesn't take us to God. So we try to focus our consciousness on those things which take us towards Krishna. And other things, we keep a safe distance from them in such a way that we don't get distracted or deluded. But if at all we get deluded, then at that time, we try to understand that this is something here which is a healthy need to be fulfilled in an unhealthy way. So rather than just trying to use willpower to curb the craving, you can see what healthy need is this unhealthy craving or distortion of. And then we try to fulfill that healthy need in a healthy way through something devotional, whether it is a need for belonging, whether it is need for relief from life stresses, whatever. And lastly, I concluded, when such a problem comes in our life, we don't beat ourselves up, but rather we pick ourselves up, focusing on Krishna. So we may fall down, but we don't have to fall away. And if somebody has fallen down, if we start publicly speaking about it and condemning it, then it's like, we not only make them fall away, we may kick them away. So when a soldier, when somebody falls down, you can see them like a wounded soldier. They need the hospital, not the prison. And if, so generally, the traditional cultures are face-saving. The purpose of that is that we don't speak about the failures of the great souls, of those who are greater than us. The idea is help them to maintain their position. Lord Shiva is such a great devotee that he is ready to lose face so that he can glorify the Lord. So such a test is not normally sent to any ordinary devotee. And we shouldn't think that we are actually doing anything good for others if we are broadcasting their failures or faults. And if at all for the purpose of awareness, making someone aware, making ourselves or others aware, we have to discuss some things like this. The test is we should not get any pleasure in discussing about it. And we should speak in such a way that doesn't give a negative picture of that person. We appreciate that person as much as we can in that situation. And thus, we can have a society where we all encourage others to move towards Krishna in spite of whatever slips or falls we may have. So Lord Shiva lost fame, but through that loss of fame, he gained fame. He demonstrated love for Krishna and he deepened his love for Krishna. Thank you very much.
Hey Krishna.
Are there any questions or comments?
One question, Prabhu.
Yes,
thank you, Prabhu, for deeply explaining the Mohini Murti form and love of Lord Shiva. But it's easy to understand when a devotee is glorified directly, like Lord Shiva glorification when he drank the poison. But this way of glorification is very difficult to comprehend.
Correct.
And we. And in Kali Yuga, right, we don't have that depth of understanding.
Right.
So, it create a lot of misunderstanding than proper understanding, Prabhu.
Yeah, it's true. So, this kind of depth, if we don't have understanding, can create misunderstandings. Yes, that's true. And that's why we need the living tradition to understand the tradition. See, if we just study the tradition, we just look at the books and read the books, we'll get deluded. It's, if you consider nowadays with the digitalization of knowledge, or if we get a disease, everything about the disease we can read on the net. And can we treat ourselves? Even doctors, if the disease is serious, they won't treat themselves because they can't be so objective when they're treating themselves. So, similarly, just the knowledge of scripture is not enough. We have to get the knowledge through those who are living that knowledge. He said that the Gita lives through those who live the Gita. The Gita lives through those who live the Gita. That's why it's important for us to connect with the living tradition and get clarification, get explanation. And so we seek simple explanation and we give explanation, share the explanation with others. And of course, some people will be dismissive, some people will be derisive, they will condemn such things. But overall, if people are open-minded and they give a reasonable explanation, they will accept it. So we'll stop here. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki
Jai.
Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki
Jai.
Gaur Prima. So we have a few books here. There is. So there is Ramayana, wisdom from the Ramayana, which is describing about 20 incidents from the Ramayana and the practical application. So if a good person suddenly behaves badly, how to deal with that? If misunderstandings come up within friends or loved ones, how to resolve the misunderstandings? Or when we face difficulties, when to leave things to destiny, when to take things in our own hands. These kind of practical issues are discussed in these books. And we also have Gita for Daily Enrichment. There are 365 articles of the Bhagavad Gita, which are based on various verses of the Gita, which describe the practical.